I welcome all of you for this presentation on anti-friction bearings, which is another chapter in the module number 5. This anti-friction bearing is also called as the ball and roller bearings. I am giving here just a schematic diagram of the anti-friction bearings in two hues. This is bore diameter, which is nothing but shaft outside diameter. This is the inner ring. Then I have the balls here, a row of balls. Then there is going to be outer race. The side view, you can see the balls are equally spaced on the distance by means of the ball cage. There will be ball cages. So all these elements are very precisely manufactured. Therefore, as a result of this, this ball bearing is going to be costlier compared to general bearings. In case of the ball and roller bearing, since we are going to have the point or the line contact of the bearing with respect to shaft, as a result, the coefficient of friction generated here is going to be very, very small. Hence, loss of power due to friction is going to be very, very minimum. Now, we are going to have a graph here where the coefficient of friction F versus shaft speed. This will clearly indicate when I should use the ball bearing, roller bearing, and when I should use the general bearing. You can see this graph. The coefficient of friction here for the ball and roller bearing at the small speed to medium speed is going to be very, very low. When it comes to the higher speed, the friction increases randomly. Whereas in the general bearing, initially, at initial speed, the friction is more, but the friction is almost constant at the higher speeds. Because of this characteristics, ball and roller bearings can be used for moderate, slow and the moderate speeds, whereas general bearing has to be used for the high speed applications only. Then I have the advantages as quoted for the anti-friction bearings, which is going to be friction is low, as I said already, because of ball and point contact here, line contact. Hence, the loss of power is negligible. These require little lubrication and maintenance. Relatively accurate shaft alignment can be maintained. These occupy less axial space but more diameter space. Replacement is easy. These are the 5 important advantages. Disadvantage, I have the noise. These bearings are noisier because there is a metal-to-metal contact. As a result, they are going to be noisier. And they are going to be more expensive because of the presence of the balls, case, inner race and outer races. Then failure of the bearing can occur without any warning. As a result, it causes the damage to the machinery. Then we have the types of ball bearings. A single row ball bearing, which the example of the diagram I have given already, I have one row of balls here. So this is annularly spaced equidistance. So this type of bearing we call as a single row ball bearing. If I use a 2 balls here, one here and another one here, then it becomes a double row ball bearing. So this is single row as well as a double row ball bearing. Then I have the angular contact ball bearing, where the direction of the load carried by the bearing is going to be inclined at an angle to the radial line. This is called as an angular contact. Self-aligning ball bearings are used for, in case of there is going to be misalignment at the shaft position, so that will be accommodated by the bearing. Therefore, it is called as a self-aligning ball bearing. Special purpose ball bearings, these are used for some kind of instruments and the belt conveyors. Then we have the deep groove ball bearing. So in the design concerned, we are mainly concerned with the deep groove ball bearing. In case of the types of roller bearing, we have the single row roller bearings. So here, instead of a ball here, we will be having a small roller, like a small chalk piece. So this will be a roller here. So that's what it calls a single row roller bearing. Otherwise, it can be a double row roller bearing, tapered roller bearing, and then we have a needle roller bearing. So where in case of needle roller bearing, diameter is going to be very, very small compared to length. Therefore, we call it is going to be sewing machine and needle. Therefore, we call this a needle roller bearing. In case of the anti-friction bearings, the design is based on the equations which we governed based on the definitions. So, I have the definitions which is otherwise a design analysis or design procedure. First definition is the bearing life. Bearing life is defined as expressed in terms of millions of revolutions, or sometimes it is expressed in terms of the number of hours. According to the Palmgren, this definition is given as the life is expressed as inversely proportional to k power of the radial load. This is, f is a radial load, l is a life, either it is in hours or in million revolutions. For a different operating conditions, if I say operating condition is going to be load carried is F1, corresponding to F1, we have a life as L1. If load carried is F2, then corresponding life is going to be L2. So these two operating conditions are compared, then we are going to have by this L1 by L2 as F2 by F1 to the power of k. The same equation is expressed in the design data handbook. So as F1 by F2 as cube root of L2 by L1. Same equation, whatever I said already, it is also here. Then we have another definition called as a median life, which is represented as L10. So this is also the life of the bearing corresponding to 10% failure of the bearings, expressed in million revolutions. When we say life, it is always going to be in terms of the millions of revolutions. 10% failure meaning here is, suppose I have a batch of 100 number of bearings. I'll write here. So 100 number of bearings if I have, then out of that, if 10 bearings are going to fail at a life of 8 years, let us say, all these 900 bearings I am expecting to have a life of 10 years. This is the design expectancy. But out of this 100, if 10 fails in 8 years, then this is going to be the median life. So correspond to 10% failure of the bearing. Then we have the equivalent dynamic load PE, which means that in case of the bearings, there is a possibility that I have a radial load, I have an axial or a thrust load. But some bearing manufacturers design the bearings either based on the radial load or based on the thrust load. Therefore, it is essential to design the bearing based on the equivalent load, which is given by the equation PE is equal to XVFR plus YFA. So we can have that equation also here. So this is the equation P is equal to XVFR plus YFA. These parameters, so these parameters you can have from this particular table, table 16.3, values of V, X and Y. Where we have the deep groove ball bearing here, we have the angular contact ball bearing here. This table continues next page. We have the angular contact groove ball bearing, self-aligning bearings like that. We have the different types. So whenever we ask to design the different type of bearings, we are supposed to refer to these columns for the that particular bearing. And X and Y values are taken here horizontally. And how to get this exactly, I'll let you know with reference to example also. So V is a rotational factor. If you see this table here, V is a rotational factor. When the rotating bearing, you can see all the time V is going to be 1. If it is stationary, V is going to be different. Let us have the bearing only for supporting the rotating shaft. So V is always going to be 1. Then FR is a radial load, FA is axial load or thrust load, X, V and Y are obtained from the table. Then I have the last definition, basic dynamic load rating. This is nothing but a load carried by the bearing correspond to 1 million revolutions of the NRS. Therefore, the equation here is L10 is C by PE raised to K. So that equation also I have in the design data handbook. So you can see L10 is C by PE raised to 3 for ball bearing. L10 is C by PE raised to 10 by 3. So this 10 by 3 in the numerator is to be used when you are designing roller bearing. 3 is to be used when you are designing the ball bearing. So this is the equation for calculating C, which is nothing but a dynamic load rating, correspond to 1 million revolution of the NRS. Then I have an equation to convert life of the bearing in hours to life of the bearing in million revolutions. So life in hours, multiply that by RPM, then multiply 60, that is in terms of minute, divided by 10 power 6, that will give life in million revolutions. So we have that equation also in the design data handbook. So this is the equation what we have. So life in hours, RPM 60 divided by 10 power 6, that will give me life in million revolutions. So these are only three equations which we hardly use. Based on these three equations, I am going to define a few examples. You can carefully see examples are going to be very simple based on the few tables. So here, design of the bearing means we are going to select only number, bearing number. So that will have a SKF because you already heard SKF ball bearing, SKF roller bearing link. So SKF catalog will give you the dimensions of the bearings. Therefore, let us have an example here. A bearing is mounted to support a vertical shaft design, a deep groove ball bearing for the following data. radial load 7000 newton, axial load 2100 newton, life 162 into 10 power 6 revolutions at 300 rpm. So solution as such is, life is given 162 10 power 6. 10 power 6 if I remove, it becomes a 162 millions of revolutions. So it is going to 162. Since I have a axial load as well as a radial load, therefore I go for making the equivalent load of these two. So equivalent load equation as already given, P is XVFR plus YFA. So let us find out the XV and FR using the table, where V is a rotational factor, it is always one for inner ring rotating. FA by VFR, actually it is a V. FA by VFR, since V is always one, so as good as we omit that particular part. So FA is 2100 that is given, FR is 7000, so it comes as a 0.3. So if I go to the table of the groove ball bearing, deep groove ball bearing I am designing here. So you can find here, for single row bearings, I have FA by VFR greater than or equal to E. For double row, I have FA by VFR less than E or equal to E and greater than E. And then these are the Y values for greater than E single row and less than E or greater than E for double row. So like that, I have X values for single row, double row, Y values for single row, double row. Then what is this E? E has given, you are comparing the figure with reference to E everywhere. E, you can find it from the last column. This is the E. So for a deep groove ball bearing, I have the values of E as a 0.22, 26, 28, 3.3, 0.34, like that. Now I have got here the value of FA by VFR as a 0.3. So 0.3, when it comes here, either I have to make this FA by FR smaller than 0.3 or larger than 0.3. Now I will choose the E value as a 0.28. So therefore I am going to choose E value as a 0.28. When I choose E value, FA by VFR, which is a 0.3, E is going to be greater than 0.28. Therefore, I have arrived at a condition that FA by FR is going to be greater than E. This condition has been arrived because FA by FR I have calculated as a 0.3. E value I have selected from the last column as a 0.28. This is my choice. Therefore, this condition has resulted from this. Now, when you see this, FA by VFR greater than E, I have single row. FA by FR greater than E, also I have here, I have a double row. Both are possible here. Therefore, I go for selecting a single row preferably. So, when FA by FR greater than E, the X value is going to be 0.56 for the deep row ball bearing. Now, Y value. Y value means I have to come to this column. FA by FR greater than E, this is my condition, single row. Now, you have chosen 0.28 as E value. Move horizontally to the left side, you get E value, Y value as a 1.55. Therefore, X is a 0.56, Y is 1.55. When I substitute that in the equation, XVFR plus YFA, these values, every values I know, then I calculate this as 7175 newton. Therefore, dynamic load rating equation I know already, L10 is C by P raised to K. K is going to be 3 for ball bearing. From this, I calculate C. I will transfer these values on this side. C is L10 to the power of 1/3. K is 3. So, it becomes 1/3 here into P. So, 162 L10 life of the bearing I know by raised to 1/3 into 7175. When I calculate this and expressed in kilonewton, it is 39.11 kilonewton. So, this is the value of dynamic load rating for 1 million revolutions. Then, for selecting the bearing, I go for referring to the table here. You can see deep groove ball bearing series 62. Then next I have deep groove ball bearing again series 63. Both the series are possible. So I will select a 62 series only now. Then you refer under this column, basic capacity newton dynamic. This is dynamic load rating. See what you have calculated now. Column number 8. Then move down vertically till you get a larger value than what you have calculated. Calculated value is 39.1. Anything more than this, which is possible here. So more than that is 40.21. So 40,210. So in kilonewton, it is 40.21 kilonewton. Then I move horizontally. Then I will get here bearing of basic design escape. This is escape catalog which has a design. So you will get as a 60 to 12 bearing for this particular dynamic loading. So I am writing here, I am selecting 60 to 10 number of 12 number of bearing with a C value of 40.21 kN. When you come to this catalog again, you have a diagram which is given here. This is the bore diameter. You have a ball over here, row of balls. This is width of the bearing. This is the outer diameter, capital D. So these dimensions are given already. So you can see here small d 60 millimeter, capital D 110, B as 22. So these dimensions you are required to mention. That means that this bearing which you have selected 60 to 12 is suitable for a shaft of 60 millimeter diameter. That's the meaning of that. So therefore, these values you are required to mention here. Bearing number, whatever you have selected, what is the capacity of that 40.21 from the catalog, and what are the dimensions of the bearing that you are required to mention. So design the bearing means only this much. You have already three equations. Using the catalog, you will get all the data. Then I have another example here. Determine the type and size of the bearing for 75 mm shaft with 350 rpm speed. The radial load is 10 kN with a very light shock and axial load is 2 kN. The instrumentation is in service for a year with 2 hours per day in use or in operation. Therefore, the life of the bearing, directly instead of giving number of hours, he has given how many hours he is being used per day and how many years. Like, so from this, you should be able to arrive at the life of the bearing. Therefore, life of the bearing, LH is going to be, life, LH means life in hours. I am using 2 hours per day, that is 2. It is used for a year. 1 year it's being used, in 1 year, 365 days. Therefore, it becomes a 2920 hours per year you are using the bearing. This number of hours you are converting into number of million revolutions, that is LH into RPM into 60 by 10 power 6. When you substitute all the values here, you will get a 61.32 million revolutions. Again, you have the two loads. One is going to be the radial load, another is going to be an axial load. So therefore, your duty is to get the equivalent load. So it's a deep groove ball bearing. Again, V is equal to 1, FA by VFR first I calculate, 2 kN by 10 kN given, so it comes to the 0.2. Then E value I will select here. Okay. So from the same table, E value is going to be 0.19. Since I got a 0.2 value here, 0.2, FA by VFR is 0.2, either you can select E value is 0.19 or 0.22, it is left to you. If I select 0.19, which is where I get as FA by VFR as larger than E, that condition I will get. Therefore, again, I can go for selecting a single row. For single row, X has FA by VFR greater than E, I have 0.56. Then Y value, FA by FR greater than E, I will get this corresponds to 0.19 as 2.3. This is how you are required to refer. So Y value as a 2.3, X value as a 0.56. When I substitute in equivalent load equation, you will get equivalent load.